Today, I'd like to talk about BNA, or Brand New Animal, the new Studio Trigger anime. And without a doubt, it is probably the most trigger anime out there. The way I'd put it is, like, if you watch a lot of anime like myself, this show is going to be like a breath of fresh air. This is going to be like not an isekai, not a slice of life thing. It's going to have that Studio Trigger Looney Tunes cool funky animation that they do. It's going to be very, very unique when compared to everyone else. But if you look at Studio Trigger's like long running line of anime, it is probably the most generic thing that they've done. Like, it takes a lot of ideas from other shows that they've already done before, and I'd say they're executed better in other shows that they have done, with the exception of Kizunaiver, but let's not talk about Kizunaiver ever again. So BNA, or Brand New Animal, follows Michiru as she turns into a half-animal, half-human hybrid. She used to be a human, and now she's an animal person. And this story is one of those Tokyo Ghoul, I'm a vampire, but I'm also a human. I used to be a human, and now I'm the other. So you have this human, and you have this other, and our main character kind of falls somewhere in between, and then comes to appreciate the other side, and kind of bridges the gaps between the two worlds. That kind of story. This kind of story is extremely prevalent. It's in Promare. You have the Burnish and you have the regular humans, and then regular humans turn to Burnish, and then you have Tokyo Ghoul, you have ghouls, and you have humans. Like, this kind of story is nothing like new. But when it comes to like having humans turn to beast people, like, I don't know what it is with humans turning into beast men. If it happens to be like Burnish, like they have fire powers, people don't bat an eyelid at that. But the second you have people turning into animals, people kind of expect something more. For example, if you think of like Beastars or maybe even a Zootopia, they take kind of like the race relations between the humans or rather the beast people and other beast people. It's very center stage, and it seems to be way more important than like a ghoul and a human in like Tokyo Ghoul, or like a Burnish and a regular human in Promare. But the fact that it's beast people and regular people that are clashing, this has created some like interesting like discussion on the internet, in the sense that people that watch this show always seem to expect more from it. Like, in terms of Studio Trigger, the ending of the story really boils down to, like, the moral of BNA is literally, I make my own decisions, I'm who I am. It's one of those kind of uplifting, don't put a label on me type stories. And it works. It works in like pretty much everywhere else. But when it comes to BNA, because it's about beast people, I feel like the wider audience just won't accept it. They want something better. I was so surprised to see that BNA only has like a 7.5 on MAL. Yes, I know what you're about to say. MAL scores are literally a joke. Scores in general are literally a joke. But they're a good way to like see what the community perception is, especially if someone would take their time to like give the show a score. And I always thought BNA had the chops to hit it big, to hit like an 8 just like Kill la Kill did. Let me try to kind of put it into perspective. BNA has essentially the same score as Sword Art Online. Sword Online, that show that's panned pretty much everywhere across the internet, like people hate on that show everywhere, and yet BNA has the exact same score. With most discussions really ending up being like, why didn't we see more? BNA should have been longer. They should have fleshed out the social construction of society when you have beast people, and since the beast people existed for so long, like, people have so many questions. But when you watch like a Tokyo Ghoul or you watch a Promare and they have the Burnish and the ghouls, nobody seems to care about like the social constructs. People are just there to watch some epic fights. But when it comes to BNA, and you have some anthropomorphic humanoid animal people, people suddenly seem to care a lot about the social structure, the society as a whole, how this would work. Is this not fascinating? Like, when it comes to like this other story, like us versus them, I'm not part of the whole, but then I kind of bridge the gap between the two of them. You see a lot of those stories. A lot of these stories are everywhere. Anime is like full of these kind of stories, like, oh, I'm half vampire, or I am part of the Kishin, like I have some kind of secret Akuma ability. It's super, super known. Or even in D. Gray Man, where you have the humans, you have the exorcists, and then you have the demons, and you have the demon people and the stuff in between. You have the altered Akuma, which are demons that are retaining their human form, and they retain their memories, and they don't have to act in the orders of the Earl. Like, there's so much there in terms of how would this work as a society, but no one asks any of these questions. No one asks. Like, none of this actually matters. We're just here to see some epic fights. But for some reason, when it comes to anthropomorphic humanoid beast people, suddenly everyone is like, we need to know how the social structure works. How are they collecting taxes? Why is there a slum? Can someone please answer these social construct questions? let me know in the comments why you think when it comes to BNA, people seem to be just so fascinated with the social construct. If you're fascinated by the social construct, please let me know why. Like, what separates this from a Tokyo Ghoul? What separates this from a I'm a half vampire, now I have to live with my vampire self? Like, why is this different? Why do you care about the social class structure, the classism that's going on in BNA? Anyways, I just cut out this long, huge rant thing that you guys probably would have just, you know, tuned out or zoned out of. But essentially, my question just boils down to, why do we suddenly have questions? Why do we suddenly need everything to add up when we touch upon anthropomorphic humans that are the other, when in like Tokyo Ghoul or the Burnish in Promare, we didn't care then. We didn't care then. So why do we care now? Why is it suddenly such a big deal now? I have no idea. Anyways, let's cut the kind of meta commentary short here and let's get back on topic. Let's talk about BNA and why, despite enjoying every single episode, I dreaded watching the next episode. Okay, so this is Studio Trigger, right? And Studio Trigger always does over-the-top violence with really kind of crazy Looney Tune type stuff. And it's fine. I really enjoyed it in Promare, I enjoyed it in Kill la Kill, I enjoyed it in the bits that were there for Kizen Iver. But when it comes to this kind of show, when Michiru was riding the top of the bus in episode 1, and we see some teenagers, and these teenagers are obviously going to beat her up and, you know, maybe leave her almost dead on the side of the road, they like shoot a crossbow bolt and like break her phone, and they go all out, like they're going to lynch her, like they're going to kill her, and that kind of like blew my mind. I was expecting a kind of happy-go-lucky show where Michiru gets off on some crazy, wacky adventures, not some like insane, they're going to kill her type deals. I did not expect regular people to be going out and killing beast people in broad daylight. I did not expect that to happen in the first episode. This juxtaposition, this contrast between the super bright and vibrant characters and colors as well, like the color palette is extremely bright, and just the darkness that is going on in the underbelly of the city. For example, Jackie and her baseball crew, they are like some cute animal people, but they live in like slums, and I know it's like played for laughs that they're stupid and they keep getting fooled by people stealing their money, but it kind of breaks my heart just a little bit. I could not close my heart to the suffering of cute animals. But that's kind of just the tip of the iceberg. For example, there's that episode where the daughter of the mafia person, she kind of goes off to meet the humans, and you just know something's gonna go wrong. And I dreaded seeing these characters getting hurt. I don't know why, I just came to enjoy these characters so much, and the bright color palette, like the highs, like they're so happy-go-lucky, and then they get pulled down to reality so fast and so hard. It was kind of jarring, but I couldn't look away. I just couldn't look away, and that's why I love this show so much. It was just so weird, like it was surreal, you know, seeing these cute animals being like super mistreated, them talking about kind of like the race relations between the humans and the animal people right after having like the funny baseball episode. And I know I kind of like talked about the show being kind of generic and being like every other Studio Trigger property, and I will stay true by that. Like in terms of the overarching story, it's very Studio Trigger, but the way they handled the villain, like the end point was still the same. The destination was the same. The villain made the same endpoint as the villain from Promare, but the direction, the journey the villain took was kind of interesting, because the villain doesn't like play in subterfuge. He doesn't do some kind of like crazy machination, evil plot type thing. He literally just tells Michiru the plan. He's like, look, Michiru, like, just relax, okay? This is what I'm doing. This is why I'm doing it. He's so good and so smooth with his talking that even now, I hesitate to call him a villain. He's more like the antagonist. And even at the end of the show, it's kind of left up in the airs. It's kind of giving him a choice at redemption. They talk about a possible redemption arc for the villain. If there is a season 2, if there ever will be a season 2, I'm guessing that's what the season 2 will focus upon. There'll probably be some kind of new big bad, and the villain, or rather the antagonist from the previous season, is going to get a chance to redeem himself. And even at the end, Michiru comments on how the drug is not inherently evil. Turning a beast person into a human is not inherently a bad thing. Like, Ogami seems to think that turning a beast person to a human is like degrading themselves, like it's super bad. She comments on how they should be given a choice. They should be given a choice on the path they want to take. If they want to stay as a beast person, that is completely up to them. which I thought was like a pretty good middle ground when compared to like Shiro's complete, we can't turn to humans, turning to humans would be completely bad and we'd lose our identity. Like, I thought it was like two extremes. You have Alan forcing them to become humans. You have Shiro Ogami just being like, no, we gotta stay beast people. We gotta figure this stuff out. And Amichiru being like the middle ground. I thought that was like a pretty nice touch towards the end. Compared to like Promare's ending, where if you compare the burnish to the beast people, they just remove all the burnish. They cure all the burnish people of their burning powers and they just turn them back into regular humans. You know, speaking of Promare, I'm reminded of Magi in the sense that in Magi, there used to be other races in the world. There were like lizard people and then there were bird people. And essentially what happened was Solomon, in his great wisdom, decided to turn all the other races into humans. So that way we could all coexist better. Like, I always thought that was like a really dumb plot point. Like, who needs to learn how to coexist and to be tolerant when we can just turn them into one of us? And before I forget, let's talk about the Nir-Vasil syndrome, because the Nir-Vasil syndrome is very, very unexpected with the way I thought they were going to handle it. So if you don't remember, the Nir-Vasil syndrome is essentially if a beast person gets really, really stressed and they're in close proximity to other different types of beast people, they will go berserk and essentially kill everything around them. I thought for sure that Alan just made up the Nir-Vasil syndrome because it's like kind of heavily implied that he controls all the information. So I thought that he was just making this up and kind of exploiting the beast people and making them think they can't live together when in reality they can. And it was all just humans meddling in the first place. But no, the show goes to great lengths to say no. The beast people cannot coexist with each other. That is why the experiment of a beast society has collapsed time and time and time again. They have failed because of the Nir-Vasil syndrome. It's only now, with science and Michiru's help, that they're able to cure the syndrome and beast people can finally come live together. So I'm guessing if you're a beast person and you come to Anima City, you're gonna have to get vaccinated for this Nir-Vasil syndrome. Otherwise, you cannot function in a human-like society. Which honestly explains a lot about the plot about why the beast people never really come together and form communities. It's because they straight up can't. And every time they do, if the size of the community gets, I guess, the size of a town or a city, it will just collapse in on itself because of the Nir-Vasil syndrome. And it was just so interesting to like have not all the blame just placed on evil humans. That was kind of a nuanced take, I suppose. It definitely did throw me off. You know that one scene that was foreshadowing the Nir-Vasil syndrome? I'm talking about the Ogami nightmare at the beginning of, I think it's episode 7, don't quote me on that, but essentially he has a nightmare where he sees other beast people go berserk and attack each other, and I thought that was setting up the Ogami other. Like, Ogami does get his foil at the very end with Alan turning out to be a purebred, but before that, the show was definitely missing the Marauder to Ogami's Doomslayer, or maybe the Sasuke to Ogami's Naruto, if you know what I mean. Ogami pretty much stays uncontested in terms of strength and power for the entirety of the show until the very end when Alan essentially reveals himself to be the Marauder to Ogami's Doomslayer. The Nir-Vasil syndrome not being fake news really, really threw me off, because when Alan reveals that he is in fact the descendant of the same person that destroyed Nir-Vasil all those years ago, I thought for sure they were going to pull a fast one, being like, humans were evil the whole time, humans orchestrated the downfall of pretty much every single big Beastmen colony ever, and it's because of that that Beastmen have never been able to rise up. But no, the fault is really kind of put on Mother Nature, and Mother Nature never really intended for Beast people to like work hand in hand with each other. So that was really like coming out of nowhere. That was a pretty good plot twist, I thought. In-universe lore aside, because if you take this into account with the in-universe lore, then that means Michiru had better send her like serum, her blood, to essentially every single beast person colony out there. Otherwise, they're facing mass extinction. Anyways, tangent aside, BNA was pretty good. When it came to like even the soundtrack, BNA had a pretty good soundtrack. And I'm not talking about like the insert song, Night Running, which is really good and I really enjoyed Night Running, but the soundtrack itself really stood out to me and I really enjoyed a few of the themes. Like the Anima City theme was really good and it really does give off this vibrant city feeling in the music. Not to mention Michiru's theme, which really gives off her personality, like this really bombastic, kind of haphazard type personality in her theme. In her theme, it starts off with like these drums and then it like ramps up into like a completely different track. It kind of throws you off, but that's exactly the kind of personality or the kind of person Michiru is. So I'm definitely giving them props for the soundtrack. BNA has a fantastic soundtrack. The animation was pretty good too. It was very Studio Trigger. You had like some Looney Tune moments with like the characters having their eyes pop out of their sockets. Overall, though, I thought the BNA was really, really good. It's so good, in fact, that I ended up watching a couple of episodes in the English dub while I was grinding in a video game or something. I thought Michiru's voice in Japanese was just that much better than the English dub, but I will give the edge to the English dub for Shiro, because Shiro, he's not from Japan in the story. You found out he's from like Europe or something, and I felt like his voice just wasn't gruff enough. So props to the dub for Ogami Shiro's voice. Ogami Shiro did a pretty good job. His dub voice actor was pretty damn good, but it's kind of like a shame to say that, because I'm about to say that everyone else in the cast was worse in the English version. I'm not saying they're bad, it's pretty serviceable as Netflix goes. Netflix has pretty good dubs, but I wouldn't put it ahead of the Japanese. A lot of the characters just fit better with the Japanese one, so edge has to go to Japan on this one. But definitely Ogami Shiro, there's something there, all right. There's definitely something there to be appreciated. So yeah, that's really all I have to say about BNA. I really enjoyed it. I thought it was really fun. It had some really cool pieces of animation and the soundtrack was fantastic. So I definitely would recommend you check it out. If you liked the video, don't forget to like, subscribe, and I'll see you guys on the next one.